Somebody had asked me last week, why popcorn? Why are we including that in the menu? And I told them, for one thing, we're actually going to have popcorn at the event. But there's also a little parallel between popcorn and politics. With popcorn, when we make popcorn, sometimes it's made with hot air poppers, hot air machines. And in politics, especially during campaign season, there's a lot of hot air that comes out of that. So we probably would do that. And we also toyed with the idea of calling it Polls, Pundits, and Paulson after the chairman of our political science department. But we polled his students, and they preferred the popcorn, so we couldn't do that.
I can smell popcorn. It smells good. Good afternoon, everyone. To our visitors, a very warm welcome to Southern. I am Dr. Betty Bergeron, the provost and vice president for academic affairs. As I'm sure you're well aware, elections are often the most effective time to let your voice be heard. It's a time when politicians and candidates seem to be the most receptive to listening to you, their constituents. It's an opportunity for voters to express their satisfaction or displeasure with incumbents and to support or oppose challengers or political newcomers. But it's also a time for voters to do their homework and learn about the candidates and where they stand on the issues. After all, a healthy democracy works best with an educated electorate. Once you have educated yourself on the candidates and the issues, part of what we're going to do today, it's then your choice to vote for the candidates you believe would best represent you, your families, your towns, your congressional district, your state, and your country. Today we hope to give a little insight into the midterm and state elections. The speakers today are not going to try to influence you in terms of who you vote for, because that is your responsibility. But they will provide some background in terms of who appears to be winning and why.
Democrats are going to go into November's elections with 32 seats, which are not up right now. Republicans go in with 30 seats. The independent senators from Maine and Vermont are not up. They've been caucusing with the Democrats. I'm not positive that they will continue to do that, because they have the chance not to, but we can count them right now. And that means if we do, that gives the Democrats 34 seats and the Republicans 30 seats. If we put in the tight races from that previous slide, which are leaning into one partisan category or the other, it leaves us with 13 Democratic victories and 19 Republican wins. So that puts us with 49 Republican seats and 47 Democratic seats. Are you on the edge of your seat? And that brings us back to this four. I really think, based on the polls, as of today, this could all change, that the balance of power in the Senate may come down to these four races: Alaska, Colorado, Iowa, and Kansas. But right now, I really think it's too close to call.
The four races. This is ranked by the percentage of ads that are purely positive. You can see Connecticut came in third with only 8% of the ads that are being aired in Connecticut for the governor's race. Only 8% of those are purely positive ads. And now when we talk about this negativity, I know I have visceral reactions to negative ads, but negativity really isn't all that bad. Having an ad like the ones we saw from Colorado, there were a lot of issues discussed in those ads. They might have been kind of nasty, but when those issues are discussed, that enables voters to learn more about the policy positions of the candidates. If all we had were positive ads, we would be certain that all of the candidates were, they loved America, they loved puppies, and they loved their families. How can we make informed choices when that's the only information that we have? So there really is something to negativity. I think there's a benefit for democracy. But those negative ads do, they provoke anxiety in some of us. But it's been found that that anxiety really can lead people to seek more information, which can be a good thing. However, once you as a voter have made the decision about which candidate you want to vote for, negative ads really can suppress voter turnout. So it goes both ways, and campaigns need to sort of pick and choose when in the cycle they're going to be using those negative ads.
I'm Marcus. I just turned 18, so I'm going to be voting. But I was curious, because you were saying to think about voting from like a historical perspective, and I was wondering to what degree you think that sometimes that might be an issue, just because a lot of times, just in my own experience, I've seen a lot of people who sort of stick with a particular party that may not even be totally aligned with what they think or what they believe politically. So do you ever feel that?
I think if you look at candidates, they are the nominees not only of parties, but they represent factions within those parties that go back a very long way. And if you identify where their support comes from, both financially and in terms of their rhetoric, they represent one faction or another. In the Republican Party, it's often been broken down into the relatively moderate Wall Street faction against the relatively conservative Main Street faction. And perhaps the conservatives are divided, and this is, the name escapes me right now, if one of my colleagues can think of it. Nicole Ray has divided the Republican Party into four factions, the two conservatives, the fundamentalists, and the stalwarts, and the more moderates and the liberals. And they represent rather consistent points of view on similar issues over long periods of time. And the Democrats, you can historically break down into the party regulars, which are more working class, more labor-oriented, more middle-class reformers, and the more moderate to conservative faction from the South. And if you identify the interest group support that a candidate has, then you can do a fairly good, and the rhetoric that they use, you can do a fairly good job of predicting whose interests they will represent in office, regardless of what they say on a particular issue, a particular